I just wanted to start off with a very personal and very human question to ask you, what is it like living in space? You were there as well in 2014, I think. So I'd be curious to know, how has it changed since you were up there last time?
Yeah, Peggy, thanks for the question. I think that what I see compared to 7 years ago is that space station is even busier than it was back then. I mean, back then I had the feeling that there was so much going on, but now it's like an order of magnitude more. There are so many more experiments. There is so much more equipment. If you look around me, you see how, you know, the density there are everywhere. There are cables, laptops, and that's just a sign of the all the hardware, all the scientific equipment that is attached to all those cables and laptops. So I think that the Space Station Program and all the international partners, including ESA, have really stepped up their game in terms of the sheer quantity and variety of activities that are on space station. And that includes both pure scientific research, like, you know, really trying to understand a scientific phenomenon, but also a lot of technology demonstrations, because we really want to make use of this amazing facility that we have, the International Space Station, to develop mature, test technologies that will enable us to explore space further beyond low Earth orbit.
Yeah, thank you. Clive.
Samantha, I'd like, please, to ask you a personal question as well about the physiological and health effects of living in space. How do you maintain a daily rhythm of waking, sleeping, working, eating, relaxing?
Yeah, thank you, Clive. So, we are on a 24-hour schedule, just like on the ground. Although, of course, we don't have this sunrise and sunset rhythm that we have on Earth, but we basically go by our watches. And we have a pretty routine, you know, day where, you know, we start in the morning around 7:30. We start our work day. We have a conference that kind of get us all synced up with all the control centers around the world. You know, Houston, Huntsville, Munich in Europe, Tsukuba, Moscow. You know, we talk to all the teams that work with us throughout the day. And then we get off to our job and, you know, we work for about, you know, 12 hours until 7:30 in the evening. That does include, and that speaks to your point of, you know, staying healthy, about 2.5 hours that are dedicated to workouts. You know, in weightlessness, a lot of our muscles really don't have to work much, you know, like you guys on the ground, now you have to like work to, you know, sit upright or stay upright or to walk. We don't have to do that. And so we really have to work out every day to prevent muscle atrophy, but also bone loss. You know, we have our meals that we try to take together as much as possible. And then in the evenings, we get a chance to relax, make phone calls. So we, you know, we try to, even up here, although we, you know, this is our home and our workplace, we try to maintain a healthy work-life balance.
Oh, well, there are quite a few earthlings that could take that advice as well. I'd like to turn to a slightly more topical subject. I'd like to know from you, Samantha, what impact has the Russian invasion of Ukraine had on your relations with your cosmonaut colleagues? And also, what future do you see for collaboration with Russia? How will we collaborate after this? And would we lose some important expertise if we do fail to collaborate?
Yes, so when it comes to the space station is very much an integrated vessel. And so there is no way to like separate its function and its ability to continue to operate, you know, from like the you know, separating like the Russian or NASA contributions, you know, or the other international partners. So you really need this cooperation to continue and stay healthy and stay productive in order to maintain space station. And I think we all recognize how important space station is. I mean, it's like this. I like to call it humanity's outpost in space. Now, of course, there's also a Chinese space station. For a long time, there was really only ISS. It's incredibly valuable because it's an incredibly unique and capable facility. You know, we're not going to have something exactly like space station for a long time to come. And so we all recognize that, yes, it's a time of conflict. Yes, we are devastated by what is happening, you know, on Earth. But we also know that we have something precious that we need to protect and preserve. And so we focus on that, both on the professional level and, you know, all the interactions that all the teams that support space station have between agencies, and certainly up here in space where we are one crew, and you know, and we focus on our friendship and on our shared commitment to space station.
Thank you.
Samantha, as you will know all too well, the amount of potentially dangerous debris in orbit is increasing the whole time. Has the threat of this extra junk affected life on the space station? And following that up, what action do you think the world should take to limit the growth in space debris or even reduce it?
Yes, for sure. This is is something that gets constantly monitored. There are assets on the ground of situational awareness where debris that might come into collision with space station is tracked. And if we're very conservative. If there is even a remote chance that such a piece of debris will hit space station, the ground controllers will work together. Again, you know, Houston and Moscow will work together to plan an avoidance maneuver. And so what happens here on space station, we are usually told, hey guys, you know, we are tracking a conjunction, that's how they're called, and you know, and as we get closer to the time where this conjunction might happen, they will decide, okay, it's clearing up, or well, we do have to move space station out of the way, and then they will turn on the engines and we will gently move to a slightly higher or lower orbit to get out of the way. But in general, it is indeed a serious problem. I mean, the orbits around the Earth, you have to, they're almost like a natural resource, right, that is available out there, and you have to preserve for use for, you know, future generations as well. And so I kind of like to compare it to aeronautical flight, right? I think somewhere in the 1940s, so mid of the last century, it was recognized that traffic was going to increase more and more. And so countries came together and developed rules of, you know, air traffic management rules so that we can all, you know, have millions of people flying every day safely around the world. And so for space, it's kind of like the same thing. So I know that there is an interagency debris coordination committee that provides guidelines for agencies and private actors to follow, and certainly that is valuable. Technology is, you know, part of the solution is going to reside in technology. I know ESA has an initiative for a demonstrator that is going to fly. It was like, you know, purchased, let's say, by ESA as a service contract from a Swiss company, I believe, and that will demonstrate the ability to launch a device that will be able to dock to a piece of debris that's been on orbit for almost a decade and safely deorbit it, bringing it back to Earth. So part of the solution is regulatory. You know, let's all plan our satellites and the operations of our satellites so that, you know, they do not, like, stay in orbit, they do not explode, they do not collide, so they do not pose a threat. And then we need to clean up the debris that is already out there, and that definitely has a technological solution to it.
Samantha, it's Peggy again. You talked about how busy the International Space Station is, how much busier it is since the time you were there in 2014, but it's been up there a while, and we know that perhaps there's a next step in space exploration beyond the International Space Station. What is your view of what that should be?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's two aspects to it. I mean, I think that there's going to be a smooth transition in low Earth orbit to private actors. There's some U.S. companies that are definitely leading the way there, but hopefully there will also be more and more European actors who want to step in that area of creating, you know, space stations or platforms for research in microgravity in low Earth orbit. And those are going to be the successors of the ISS. And then we have to look beyond that. And so going back to the moon, you know, first to cislunar space and then on the surface of the moon with obviously the long-term goal of eventually getting to Mars. And so ESA is, the European Space Agency is very much a part of that. ESA provides the service module for the Orion spacecraft that is going to bring astronauts to lunar orbit. And so that is a complex and quite significant piece of hardware that ESA has developed involving seven countries across Europe. There is Gateway. Gateway is going to be a space station, smaller than ISS, but much, much further out in orbit around the moon. And ESA is providing the international, so-called international habitat, so basically the main habitation module, as well as other components. So this international cooperation is definitely continuing. It's one of the great legacies, I think, of Space Station that, you know, we showed that that works and it's productive and it helps protect and preserve such long-term programs over the years that are necessary for such complex developments.
Samantha, it's Clive again. The private sector is obviously going to play a very important role in this expansion of space activities that you've described. I'd like you to say briefly how you see the role of corporations and companies in space, and in particular, are you worried, as some people are, about the growing mega constellations in low Earth orbit and their impact on the environment?
Yeah, I think that the impact of mega constellations is certainly something that needs to be managed. And, and it goes a little bit back to what I mentioned earlier about the necessity of managing the orbits, kind of like on the ground we manage the airspace. But of course, they are also a source of potential for, you know, economic growth and benefits for society. And so, you know, everything always brings potential benefits and then potential risks that need to be managed. But in general, I think it's very exciting that there is so much interest in the private sector. And in fact, I hope and I'm very hopeful that there will be more and more in investment in the sector, because I think that liberates ideas and potential business opportunities and potential for innovation, potential for driving down the costs of access to space, of operating in space, so that, again, more and more actors can enter the sector and participate with, you know, new ideas, new products, new services. So I think it's a virtuous cycle that I believe has started already, and I'm hopeful that it will continue to accelerate.
Thank you, Samantha. It's Peggy here, and I think we're on to our final question. So I'd like to know from you, I mean, you're a wonderful example to everybody, male and female, but we do know there are still fewer female than male astronauts, only two women and five men on the station. How can female participation, how should we increase female participation in space?
Yeah, I do have a little bit of a more positive view, I have to say. You know, in my Dragon Crew, my you know, the vehicle that I came up with, it was four of us, and it was two of us were women, so 50%. The NASA Astronaut Corps is incredibly diverse. At the European Space Agency, we have not had a selection for over a decade, so we haven't had time to, like, you know, update our our composition and catch up a little bit also with the development of society. But we have a selection that is ongoing now. And from the number of female candidates and the quality of applications that we have received, we know that there is going to be a lot more women in the European Astronaut Corps as well. Of course, you know, as an astronaut, it's my duty and my privilege to reach out, especially to young people, and try to make them excited about space and STEM in general. And of course, hopefully, also more and more women will consider that that career path and become, you know, future colleagues of ours in a capacity or another. But at the same time, I'm quite happy about the current trend.
Yeah, I think we need to wrap up in a couple of seconds. So just the last word from my side to really thank you, Samantha. It was always fantastic to hear you and to listen to you. You are such a role model. I can only repeat what I said already some time ago. So many people are inspired down here on Earth by what you do and how you do it, and also being a female colleague of ours inspires also a lot of female young candidates, young girls who want to become an astronaut. It's really beautiful to see. And maybe just a word on my side, gender balance, diversity is a top priority of ESA, as you know, in Agenda 25, and I'm doing a selection of the final candidates in a couple of months, and this is certainly on top of my agenda as well. So thank you, Samantha. It was a great pleasure. Thank you. Continue well in your work, and great applause down here from London. Okay.